A very good evening to all of you. I'm Jyoti Sharma Bawa, and I welcome you to today's HT City Spotlight on Entertainment. The Berlin International Film Festival has announced that its performance awards will be gender neutral from 2021. While all of us are welcoming the change, we all wonder if it will have a ripple effect across the world. In HT City Spotlight today, we discuss if India is ready for gender neutral awards, and importantly, whether merging gender categories would create but a cosmetic definition of equality in an industry where we know equality does not exist. Joining us in this panel discussion today is the director of acclaimed films such as Aligarh, City Lights and Omerta, Hansal Mehta.
Hi.
Hi, Hansal. Welcome to the panel.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here.
Please welcome Alankrita Srivastava, whose Lipstick Under the Burqa and the recent Dolly Kitty or Wo Chamakte Sitare have started a conversation about gender issues in India. Glad to have you here, Alankrita.
Hi, glad to be here and excited for this chat.
Beautiful. Filmmaker Ruchi Narayan, whose hard-hitting Guilty released last year to wide acclaim, is here with us. Welcome, Ruchi.
Thank you, Jyoti. Excited to be here and part of this discussion.
So are we. We are also being joined by actor Shayoni Gupta, who has impressed us with her performances in Article 15, Akhoni and Margarita with a Straw, to name just a few. Welcome, everybody. Welcome, Shayoni. Okay. Actually, my first question is to the directors. We are talking about gender neutral awards, but in your opinion, will the one for all category mean all the awards go to men, or will it lead to a more equitable distribution of awards? Please weigh in.
Would you start?
So firstly, when we talk about awards, I think we're specifically talking about the actor awards, because all the other awards are gender neutral. There's no best woman director award, or you know, best male costume designer award. So it's about the actors, and of course actors, as talented as they may be, are definitely dependent on the kind of roles they get, and the screen time and how layered their characters are in order to be able to perform. So in my view, it is definitely going to be skewed in India, it's our film industry and the kind of stories we are telling right at this moment are very skewed still towards men and the male narrative. So it will have that kind of an effect that will be reflected in awards. There are many other points which I think I should let some other people speak as well, so that it doesn't become a monologue and we all have something new to say.
Hansal and Alankrita, please go ahead.
Well, I just like to say that I kind of agree with what Ruchi said, that I think it's very exciting, when you feel like the divisions, will sort of melt away, and a performance is a performance. It really doesn't matter whether it's it's a male performance or a female performance. Very much like it doesn't matter whether it's a male director or a female director or a male cinematographer or a female cinematographer. I think as an idea, it's very exciting, and I think it is something to sort of move towards. My only fear is again the same thing, that the moment you do that, does it mean that a fewer women will get these awards, because they don't have those kind of, enough women are not getting those kind of meaty roles. So it'll always be like, oh, but that performance was so much more complex, so much more layered, it was so meaty, simply because there are many more films which are giving men those kind of parts. So I think my worry is only that it shouldn't end up actually taking us a few steps back in terms of you know, making sure that female actors get as much recognition and respect as male actors. So that is, I think, you know, my main sort of thought. And I don't know, maybe Hansel can share more light on what he feels.
I have a broader perspective on this. You know, while what Berlin has done is very welcome decision, and you know, it's a step in the right direction. That kind of neutrality in judging performances and all that. But I mean, in India, we are ripe for a systemic change. I mean, we desperately need our awards themselves. You know, most of the time are a farce because you know they're television shows. So, I mean, would a television show want? You know, awards are given on the basis of who is coming to the awards. You know, awards are given on the basis of not merit every time. And I just feel that, I mean, there's a bigger overhaul of the system that is required. And that includes that inbuilt, you know, chauvinism and misogyny that sort of exists within our system. And that is not only in film, in general, in our society. I mean, as an industry, expected to take the first step, you know, in, showing the way. Like, we taught the entire country to consume drugs. We are expected to, you know, be gender neutral. I think generally, you know, that neutrality, while being a great idea, I think our awards also need a major overhaul. I mean, you know, the entire system, the way the media projects men and women, the way, you know, your journalism, you know, journalism about films and film stars. I mean, all that needs to change. The lens has to be less misogynistic. And so there is a much larger change required by getting this kind of gender neutrality in some of our awards. I think we'll be making a symbolic change and not a systemic change. That is my, I'm a bit cynical considering the way things are and the way our industry is, you know, the society perceives us as a whole. It's not only about the industry itself, it's the way we have been made to be perceived, you know, the way your media. And because of that perception, the way the public treats women in our films, I mean, that objectification has to stop. It's a larger systemic change that is required. And yeah, some sort of symbolism might help.
Actually, that is an issue we are going to touch upon at length, you know, a little later in the discussion. And but that is a very interesting point that you have stated. I completely agree with you. My next question is to Shayoni. So do you think, you know, when talent is being awarded and not gender, will this translate into better roles being written for women? You know, it can bring about or at least start a conversation around gender parity and pay parity?
You know, I think we are trying to get to a result before we've solved the main problem. And I actually agree with all three of them here. Which is, of course, you know, it's a progressive thought when it comes to making an award, any award, which is more gender neutral, which is more non-binary, you know, and especially there are a lot of actors, a lot of people who don't identify themselves as part of either of the genders, right? Trans people, for example. But before we get there, we need to first solve the problem at the grassroots, which is we don't have representation, enough representation of women. Roles being written, meaty roles written, you know, more interesting roles written for women, roles written for trans people, for queer people. Most of the, and not just in Bollywood or the Hindi film industry, even Hollywood, historically you've seen the roles that are written for men are way more interesting and better and more in volume as well. So unless and until we work on representation in writing, there is no point, you know, trying to solve this problem. Because, and again, as you said, gender parity, pay parity, you know, again, you know, the dignity attached to just art and talent, all of that needs to change. And that change has to be more systemic. It can't just come as, you know, because the moment you change, you know, just an award show, it's more like a tokenism, in my opinion, and not just not just a systematic change in trying to see stories, you know, from a more gender neutral representative way.
Thanks, Yoni. In fact, that is something that I also wanted to touch upon, because, you know, even when we see LGBTQI actors represented on screen, we rarely see LGBTQI actors playing them. The roles might be there, but it is rare that, you know, they are cast there. So Alankrita, what is your take for it? What do we need to change in terms of, you know, better representation and to make it more gender fluid, the whole industry and in and perhaps the society?
So, you know, I really agree with everything Hansal said and what Shayoni said. I think that, you know, it is important to actually take a step back and look at the system itself that has created so much inequality, you know, when we look at the culture of cinema in India. And I think, like, I don't know, rather than maybe making awards gender neutral, should it be that, you know, studios should follow a policy where half the films that they produce should be headlined by women, you know, like women directors and women protagonists, to create like a more equal space? I mean, not that it should not necessarily that should be prescribed, but that is some kind of something that, you know, like they can sort of strive for and put some sort of like a goal, like a 50-50 kind of a goal. So should, you know, all studios and production houses be doing that, actually, all the stuff that they're producing, you know, like right at the level of where is the money going, where are the resources going, just start dividing it in a fair way. So actually in Europe, I remember reading that a lot of the film commissions started doing this thing in some of the Scandinavian countries, that, you know, like 50% of whatever films are being commissioned and funded had to go to women filmmakers, because that would also mean a much more diverse range of stories, because they obviously often had, not always, but often, you know, brought different kinds of sort of stories to the screen. So I'm just saying, maybe that is the kind of thing we should be, you know, looking for, because I think, like, at the end of the day, you know, it's I do feel like a lot of it is a fight for resources. And the thing in India is, because we don't have any separate funding for sources for, you know, smaller films, for independent films, for, it's like everyone is just like, eventually to release your film, I mean, I'm talking about pre-COVID times, I don't know what's going to happen after that, you know, you're just fighting for in the same exhibition system, the same distribution system. So, you know, whether you have to release a Masaan or a Bajrangi Bhaijaan, you know, a Killa or, you know, Rowdy Rathod, you're fighting for the same, like, for the same resources, which makes it very unfair. Ticket prices are, you know, not priced in a way that makes it accessible to go for a smaller film, and smaller films never get those kind of budgets. So even the audience, and then of course we blame the audience, but the audience is always being fed, you know, the male superstar kind of advertising. So they're also only aspiring to go watch those films. So it's a really huge cycle, and exhibitors don't give the programmers at, you know, who are employed by exhibitors, they don't give proper show timings to films, which, I mean, I know I've always fought for show timings. So you know that, you know, there are all those kind of systemic things, which is the reason why I feel like alternative films with alternative points of view, whether it's a queer point of view, it's a very clearly female point of view, those kind of films don't get that kind of space. So I think, like, maybe, you know, and I agree, like, maybe, like, the awards thing is a very later in the stage kind of a thing. Maybe what we first need to do is, like, how do we make sure there are more films that are made, you know, which really have all kinds of protagonists, which, you know, whether they are trans or they're, you know, like, also, like, men who are on the fringes rather than necessarily being, you know, the very alpha male, you know, sitting right on top of that privilege pile sort of a thing. So I think these are the, I don't know, maybe this is something to sort of think about.
Yeah.
So perhaps everybody is saying that we need systemic changes before we actually think about award functions that come later in the line. So what are the systemic changes that you want to see in the film industry, among the audience, the way the films are made, the way the films are distributed?
You know, if I may add quickly to what Alankita was saying, again, answering your question, that, any film with a female protagonist is called female-centric films. But any film with a male protagonist is a universal film. You know, you don't call it a male-centric film. So, again, you know, when we look at a film, we don't look at a film just as a film about any, you know, character or story, but we are constantly trying to put them in different brackets or boxes. And that is, again, as a viewer, also as a producer, as a maker, creator, we all have to enable each other so that we stop looking and categorizing films in terms of what the protagonist is and what the gender of the protagonist is or the race of the protagonist is. So those kind of things, I think, are extremely important for us to understand as a society, and it's just not going to happen just as an industry, you know.
I just want to add as well that the essential question is about our society. So the film industry and everyone in the film industry, including the audience, we are part of the same society. So when we want change in terms of how gender is perceived, it has to come from and it has to feed into the whole society. Now, as a film industry, we may take the view that we are reflecting the way life is, which is more male-centric, or we want to take a stand that we can also be, formulating ideas and putting new ideas out there. The problem that happens is when things are driven by commerce, as they are in our industry, and there's actually no parallel body or avenue aside from the commercial aspect, then everything starts feeding into the way society is. But if we want society and therefore everything else to start changing, then we have to propose ways to do it. Like Alankrita was saying, there has to be more representation of women's stories. And I'm saying women particularly because half your population is women. So of course, there are other points of view and, other groups of people. But can we talk about women, because that's half your population? So let's deal with that first. Either as an industry or we come together and we say that we should have an allocation of this many stories about women, this many women directors and producers who are leading projects, so that you just have their points of view coming in. I mean, it's one of the reasons you find actually a sea change in content and conversation with the coming of OTT. Earlier, people used to say, but where are the women filmmakers? Where are the film directors and the women film producers? We are all here. We've been here for years, trying really hard to get some money to show our stuff. When OTT has come, suddenly you see a lot of women makers are coming out, because we've all been sitting with content. We've just not had the opportunity of getting the finances and the financial backing, which means people with money who trust women with their money make content. Yeah. And a lot of that content has done really well. So it's not that it's not commercially viable. We've just not been given that kind of trust with resources, which, of course, speaks of the society that we live in, because that's where everyone is from.
Hmm. I want to add to what Ruchi has said. You know, the primary factor responsible for this kind of skewed, you know, sense of equality, this skewed gender bias that we have in our industry, is mainstream cinema. And what makes a film mainstream? The audience. The audience wants to watch, you know, the perception is that the audience goes to watch an Akshay Kumar film, or the audience goes to watch a Salman Khan film, and that those films make 300 crores. And I mean, we as an industry have to constantly reinvent what mainstream really means. And, you know, the alternative filmmakers, independent filmmakers, have written some remarkable films, made some remarkable films with female characters at the fore. But unfortunately, they are not perceived as mainstream, which is, you know, and that commerce has a lot to do with the audience, you know, and I've always said that, you know, I had somebody complaining that, oh, you know, your films have terrible, you know, Hindi music, Hindi films have terrible songs these days. I said, because you guys consume them.
Yeah.
You know, and there are people who come and tell you terrible stories. I said, because you consume them. I mean, if you don't like so-and-so superstar's films, why the hell do you make it such a big hit? Why do you go to the theater? Why do you consume it? You know, so consumption somewhere, you know, I always feel it's a two-way traffic. I mean, the people who fund us are primarily driven by, you know, returns. And those returns are very, I mean, there's no layering in the way those returns are measured, frankly. You know, if a film has done an X number, irrespective of whether it's a profit or a loss, you know, how many mainstream films that are perceived as hits, whether it's a profit-making film or has it given a return on investment, people are just happy with that perception and they follow that herd. I mean, we need to break that herd mentality as an industry and as an audience. I think as an audience, we need to evolve more. And I think the lockdown in that sense is a great time to reflect, because you don't have, you know, you cannot go to the theaters. You don't have those blockbusters. And I don't know if the blockbusters will stand up against, say, a film like Guilty on an OTT platform. You know, the neutrality is coming out of this equal playing field. You know, we are given a playing field. We are on an OTT platform. You have Dolly Kitty Ki Chamakte Sitare releasing today. 2 weeks later, you have an Akshay Kumar film. There are no box office figures released. A good film is a good film. It is watched. It is appreciated. And a bad film, no matter how big the star is, I mean, I can tell you how many films that have come on OTT in the past few months with big stars have actually been trash. Whereas films that actually deserved a great sunshine, which would have been, you know, pathetic at the theaters, and, you know, you would have had producers coming, you see, I told you, these films don't work. Chalte nahi hai. So, I mean, you know, that the lockdown has, in that sense, been a blessing in disguise for some of the films that, you know, were otherwise finding it very difficult to find expression. You know, not able to find that proper exhibition. And I feel that OTT and, you know, all these alternative mediums, I mean, we need to fuel them. They need to reciprocate, we need to fuel them. You know, there's an alternative energy that has been created, an ecosystem that has been created. We need to keep energizing it, because we are otherwise a part of a very tired and a very age-old ecosystem, which is fueled by misogyny, which is fueled by chauvinism, which is fueled by hero worship, you know. And that hero worship is not going to end, because, you know, no matter what you do, you can ban tobacco chewing, but people still consume tobacco. And it's a bad habit that is consumed. But you can have alternative spaces. So I think the need is to fuel those alternative spaces in a more productive manner. And similarly, awards. I mean, awards need to be there. You need to have, with this lockdown, you're forced to reflect and introspect. And the awards are valueless. They're just a TV show. You know, how does it matter?
Yeah.
You know, and I think we need to look back and say, you know, how can we make our awards more dignified? You know, first of all, restore the dignity of the awards and then talk about being gender neutral. I mean, our awards lack dignity in the first place.
Yeah,
actually, that you bring me to my next question is, should awards be taken seriously or they completely lack the prestige, the credibility to actually drive a positive change?
Well,
I want
to answer that. I have
you already have
the national awards, in the last 6 years have been at varying stages of importance. They sometimes you feel that they're credible and important, but at least they're more credible than the other TV shows. Everything else is a TV show, including, I mean, there's an award by the Film Critics Association and all that. Everything. I mean, I just feel that we need a little more dignity. We need to be dignified. We need to be less starstruck. You know, don't keep giving all these token awards to Rajkumar Rao, a critics award. I mean, what the hell is a critics award? I mean, just because you have to assuage, somebody has given an exceptional performance, you give him a critics award, and then you will give some mediocre performance, best actor, and that guy will give some 45-minute speech. And you do the same thing with, it's across the board, acting is one thing. I mean, directors, writers, cinematographers. I mean, we have no dignity. We are starstruck. And I will tell you this. I mean, when the awards are held, we know much before that award who is getting what award. If you don't get a call, you're not getting the award. So you're nominated because, Garibo ko bhi nominate karo. It is that way. Representation. This is what representation has come to in our country. We talk about representation, we talk about Dalits, we talk about LGBTQ. It's all a fucking scam. Sorry, I don't know if I'm supposed to use that word. It's an eye wash. It's an eye wash.
Yeah.
Yeah. Here.
Who else is completely irritated with the Critics' Choice Awards? Please raise hands.
No, I mean, Critics' Choice still, I think, has some sort of merit, the one that's just started a couple of years ago, I think. But, generally the awards, like Hansel sir was saying, that, if you have an iota of dignity or self-worth, and you happen to go to any of these awards, and Garibo like us, who get nominated just for the name of representation, representation of tokenism or whatever it is, obviously, we'll never get the award, but you're made to feel so terrible about yourself. It's just bizarre. It's just like really hilarious what all actually happens and goes on, including when you get there, you are on, you're made to sit on the first row. But, and this is something I actually discovered the first instance when I went to one of these big awards, that, I was very happy that I was in the first row, and then the rows kept getting added in front of you. So by the end of the night, you're on the 12th row. Okay. I've also gotten, they've also started selling, seats to audience members who are not from the industry. So anybody who has like a couple of lakhs to spare, and it's actually a lot of money people are giving out. So there was one time when, this huge award show happened, and I literally got groped in the red carpet. Because there were so many random men feeling you up who have nothing to do with the industry. They're just there because they've just bought tickets. And so it's just a nightmare. Every time very few times I've gone, only when I've been nominated. Every time I've promised myself never going back, but I keep going back for some reason. But yeah, it's just it's a nightmare, and it's really horrifying. It's horrifying. And as Hansel sir was saying, that there is no dignity for the awards, yes, but there's also no respect for the people you invite. Like, even the technical awards, if you see, that they're just given away. Somebody's like, you know, the teleprompter is not working, people are not there, there is no conversation between backstage and the stage, and people who, you know, it's just literally, I have friends who have been given awards for a different category, for a wrong category, and nobody is even there to forget about apologizing, or even like, no, like no one has a clue. So it's just bizarre, the whole setup. So it's nothing but a televised show, and it's made for sponsorships and things like that. So I don't think this conversation is really about the Indian Awards, because then it's a different conversation altogether, you know. It's yeah.
No, I just totally agree with what Shaini was saying, because I also feel like if you look at our awards, we'll see how far we really are from, like, you know, like the Berlin Film Festival awards. Like, I know that, you know, like, standards are very, very different for independent films. And I totally agree, like, half the times, like, many deserving films don't get nominated, or if they get nominated, like, I remember, you know, Ratna Patakshan for Lipstick, she never got nominated for a lead actor category except in one awards. Everywhere they kept putting her as a supporting actor, which was very odd. And so, you know, it's like those kind of things. So I do feel that, I think going back to that point of these kind of awards, I think they really don't aid inclusion and diversity. So I remember even for Made in Heaven, we were invited for some awards, and you know, they gave us an award. I've forgotten which award show it was. They gave us an award, which was for the show that has created change. But they never gave us, like, any of the main awards. And I remember we were thinking, it's so strange that for some reason you feel like a show which has a gay protagonist, somehow it, you know, it almost felt like they felt, you know, like it wasn't mainstream enough for them to give us that award or something. So I don't know. So I feel like definitely these awards anyway are so problematic. So they definitely are not helping in creating a space for diverse kind of a protagonist. And therefore, like, you know, will a trans person ever make it to these awards? Of course not, the way the situation you know, is right now. And I think, so there are so many issues. I feel also censorship is a huge issue, because of which we don't have diversity in protagonists, because I feel like only recently homosexuality is no longer a crime, which just happened like literally end of, you know, like just about a year and a half ago. But there are hardly any films with, you know, with gay and or queer protagonists, because there is censorship. So we can come to that point later where, you know, are we making sure that a trans person is the person who's playing a trans character? Are we making sure that enough actors who, you know, who of different kinds of sexuality are they getting work? So those questions are also, I feel, are secondary. Right now, it's like we can't even tell those stories, you know, and luckily, I feel if the streaming services, at least that has changed, and you know, some of those stories can be told. But like, so rare. For instance, there was Aligarh. It was like one of the few films which actually, otherwise there are no, I can't, like, I can hardly think of any films which have any kind of you know, a protagonist who are dealing with an alternative sexuality. So I think there are very, very deep questions of what kind of cinema culture India has, how it kind of is pretty much a reflection of a very, very patriarchal structure. And I do feel like even issues like censorship actually come into, you know, play. So I think, like, I think this awards is a great way to open out the conversation, but it's very clear that, you know, it's actually about so many, you know, so many other things.
You know, there was a...
Yeah. But Alan,
When Manoj Bajpayee did not get... National Award for Aligarh, there was a lot of outrage. There was a general outrage. So the chairperson of the jury had to respond. So he said, how can it get an award? Nobody has seen the film. So the jury did not even get the film.
Yeah.
Obviously somewhere, some lower jury, you know, the zonal jury did not even send the film. And they did not bother. So Akshay Kumar got it that year for Rustam. So, I mean, generally, for Rustam or for Airlift. He got it for that. And, you know, so, I mean, if the most credible award in the country, the only credible award in the country also is governed by populism, you know, I mean, political bias is going to be there because it's a good sponsored award. And I'm letting that go. I'm letting that pass for now because, you know, we are anyway in a very hopeless situation right now. So, but at least watch the films that deserve your attention. That's, you know, that's the least you can do. You know, that was even more insulting. Yeah.
Sorry. No, just to play devil's advocate, Margarita with the Straw did get actually nominated for all the awards. Actually, Kalki and I got nominated. And Kalki got a national award. So, I mean, just to play the devil's advocate, so that did have the alternate sexuality. And yeah, so, but yeah, it doesn't happen all the time. I mean, it's so rare that it happens. Yeah.
I so also
did you get the best, most popular actor? Did you get best actor? Or you
no,
best
no, critic. Critic and supporting. Critic and supporting, yeah.
And I have a problem with that.
Yeah.
And why is the last award? I mean, the Oscars also need to take a lead in. Why is the last award for best actor or best male performance?
Yeah.
You know, give the male actor, I mean, push that award down. No? If symbolism has to begin, first push them. Stop giving so much importance to the damn male performance.
Yeah.
You know, let the female actor.
Oscars haven't been very fair either. Like in their entire history, only 4 women directors have been nominated, and only
5.
One has
And for Hurt Locker, Catherine Bigelow got it. But also, I mean, only in 2018, you know, for Mudbound, Rachel Morrison got for best cinematography, the first ever. You know,
first ever.
In 92 years, so clearly there is a problem.
Yeah. I mean, I just wanted to add that there was a study even in Hollywood that the women directors and producers actually have a higher return on investment in all their projects. And yet, like, there was only 8% of the films that year which had women directors, so there are a lot of studies like that. But what I wanted to say is because our industry in particular is only currently commercially driven. Like, say, in the 80s or before that, there was at least a government body, NFDC, whatever you may say about them or their films, people have their opinions. But at least when those kind of bodies exist, they can frame rules and they can frame things that we are going for. Like, for example, let's tell these many women's stories. Let's encourage these kind of Dalit stories. But when you lay everything open to only commercialism, then everything is bound by what people think the audience wants. So, in other countries, especially in Europe, and you know, of course, it started with the conversation started because of the Berlin Film Festival. But especially in Europe, they have most countries have very have a lot of bodies, have a lot of government agencies, and even independent agencies which are trying to encourage films, stories about and from other points of view aside from a male point of view. So I think we definitely need some of that because in the end, films are an expensive proposition. So you can't actually make them without money. So unless we are going to get funded, I mean, again, because of OTT, a lot of that is being taken care of. But unless you have people who have an idea to promote representation, it's not going to happen by itself. It's not going to happen if you just leave it to commercialism, because like Hansal was saying before, the audience is consuming this, or at least the idea is that the audience will only consume this. So you're not even giving the audience, frankly, a fair chance, because you are assuming the audience won't want to see this film. So you're only giving it a morning show, or you're giving it an 11 p.m. show. Maybe they would have liked it if they could see it, which is again something the OTT is doing. So I do feel that if, even as an industry, in terms of the quality of our content, if we want to improve, and we really do need to improve, we have to take these kind of decisions, stands, and invest in the other, in other perspectives, because that is the only thing that's going to improve content. And, you know, creating empathy in the society, how else is it going to change?
That's a very valid point. We have, you know, some of the readers writing into, some of the audience members also writing into us. So Ruchi Mathur, I think she was listening in and heard about our Oscar conversation. So she's asking, why should we draw parallels with Oscars anyway? Perhaps it's a point on, you know, India's fixation with Oscars. How do you guys weigh in?
I mean, I think it's interesting to draw parallels with Oscars simply because it's the most... it's the biggest film award show in the world, and it's really like, I mean, it's another thing that it's you know, got its issues, and it's not itself very representative, but it's the aspirational thing of like, those are the most important film awards in the world in that sense. I think to draw parallels would be simply for that reason. And so I think, yeah, I don't know. And I wonder whether the Berlin decision, I don't know if it's going to ever have any impact on, eventually on, you know, the Oscars, and whether they're going to start thinking about changing their awards categories. I don't know.
But even if you talk about, like, I'm going to nerd out a little bit, please bear with me. But even if we have to talk about other award shows, like the Television Critics Award, you know, have a gender neutral award for the drama and comedy category. And in the last 20 years that they've existed, 67% of the nominations and 69% of the winners have been men. The BAFTA Rising Star Award, which is a gender neutral award, and is, you know, the jury is mostly mindful of, it says, including diverse nominees. In the last 12 years, 9 winners have been male and 3 female. So it's just not about the Oscars. When you look at even the other awards, you can see that there is, you know, like, it's bent towards favoring men over women for whatever reason. You know, it could be bias. It could be just in terms of the roles written better for men, as we were discussing earlier. So, yeah, it's difficult. Like, according to 2014, there's a study by the Center of Study of Women in TV and film at San Diego State University, women comprised of only 12% of protagonists and 30% of all speaking characters in the biggest blockbusters of the year. So this is representative of our reality right now. Sorry about that, yeah.
No, I think it really makes sense. I feel even if you look at the categories which are gender neutral, like say best film or best director, or like we discussed, best cinematography, it's the same thing. Like, women hardly get those awards. Those awards always go to men. So it'll just be a pity if that starts happening. But maybe, I guess there is something positive also that we should think about, like why Berlin has, done this. And I don't know, that's also something to sort of think about.
At least has started a conversation.
No, definitely. And I think Berlin, in a way, it's good because it is the ideal. I mean, ideally, it should be gender neutral. Yeah. And probably Berlin was able to do this also because the society is way more egalitarian in terms of opportunity and representation. So you have a, you have that basis. But again, it's not commercially driven. The film
exactly.
Festival. So it is actually trying, of course, all awards are subjective, but it is based on a kind of a assessment on talent, ability, portrayal. So they are able to do it. And because women's stories are not as common in the mainstream, a lot of them, even when they're made or even if they're made for mainstream, do go through a festival route. So you will see most festivals, there is a large number, maybe it's an equal number, I don't know the figures, Shioni will be able to tell us. But there is a large number of films which have a gender representation and they are more gender neutral. So therefore those awards can afford to try and become gender neutral and they may still probably end up being fair. But in our industry and in our society, we are very, very far away from this. It's a dream right now.
Yeah. And I think also to keep in mind that Berlin maybe is a more progressive festival in many ways than say Cannes, where there hardly any, you know, again, like female directors there have hardly like ever been, you know, been sort of recognized. Yeah. So I think it's also very particular maybe to the Berlin festival.
Exactly. I mean, you can't also, it's not on the same platter. You can't have the same prism to look at all festivals. And first of all, like the Berlin Film Festival or the Venice Film Festival or Rotterdam is very different from, say, a Cannes, which is extremely different from an Oscar, which is a commercial-driven film festival, you know, commerce-driven film festival, will be very different from a Toronto to a South by Southwest. So, you know, or to a Palm Springs. So every film festival has their own, for a lack of a better word, agenda, for a lack of, you know, for a different kind of categorization in terms of who are the jury that are chosen for that film festival, who are the people in, you know, who are concerned, who are part of, you know, who are the decision makers. So, and clearly none of this comparison can be made to the awards in our country. So it's a sea of difference.
Well, here's hoping for that more alternative voices come forward. We are more amenable to watching and, you know, applauding them. And that brings us to the end of this chapter of HTCT Spotlight. It has been a pleasure listening to all of you, hearing your perspectives. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jyoti. Bye.
Thank you. Lots of love.
Bye, Ruchi.